In October 2016, less than a year back, he was conferred with the Paul Appleby Award for rendering outstanding service in the field of public administration by IIPA. That is a singular honor which a bureaucrat can ever get. At present, Dutt Saab is in the corporate world. He is Vice President and Member of the Executive Council of Indian Institute of Public Administration, that is IIPA, which I mentioned, Member of the Advisory Board of the Center for Joint Welfare, Ministry of Defense, Chairman of Angika Development Society for Education and Queen's Global Academy, UK. He is Member of the Advisory Board of Gujarat Technical University, Ahmedabad, for Ek Rakshta, Member of the Governing Board of University of Engineering and Management, Kolkata, President of the Advisory Board, South Asia Foundation, Director General of the Solar Power Developers Association, Member, Central Board, Harijan Sevak Sangh, Chairman of the Advisory Board of Chanakya Center for Strategic Studies, that is where the brains of the country are, and he is the patron member of the Advisory Board of Cyber Peace Foundation. These are the things in which he is involved, and today, at this moment, he is with us, involved with Sri Balaji Society. Sir, we thank you indeed for coming here, spending time with us, and may I now request you, sir, to kindly come and enlighten all of us. Thank you, friends. Over to Captain Shekhar Dutt, Sena Medal.
One important thing which I have learned from my father is that don't be satisfied by completing the work. Be satisfied only if you feel yourself that nobody could have done a better job. Now, if that is there, then what happens? 1 + 1 = 2. 1 + 1 = 11, and that is our strength. We have to actually leave no effort and understand the whole mechanism. How do we start a work and how do we finish it in a manner that nobody can do any better job than that? India has been the producer of ideas. If we go through the literature which our ancestors have evolved right from the Puranic period, every bit, whether it is Gita or the Puranas, any Mahabharata, Ramayana, every bit of the literature is full of wisdom. And people have written. In fact, I did not know, and I came to know only last year from my nephew, who's a PhD in mathematics and who's a thinker, that Adi Shankaracharya had written Mahishasur Mardhini, the shlokas. And it's a treat to read it, because the way it rhymes, the way the words have been chosen, and the way the words have been arranged around 2000 years ago is completely out of the world. And that was from the Adi Shankaracharya. What did he do? He collected India together, and he laid the foundation of something which is absolutely unique. He created 4 speeds of Shankaracharya, and he ensured that none of these speeds would be headed by a local man. It would be headed by somebody from outside. That is Bharat, that is India. Because when we call Bharat, it is the entire Vishal Bharat. So every Bharatiya has to be a proud human being. There's a lot of difference between what we know as being proud and what we know as being insolent. In Hindi or Sanskrit, there's a lot of difference between garva, which is pride, or ghamand. Now, something we must differentiate. We should be garvit that we are Indians. We should be garvit that we are part of the Balaji Society educational system. We should be proud that we live in Pune and everything. But that proud pride comes out of humility. Must understand that I have a responsibility. Because I think that this is a best place, I have that responsibility also comes that I must ensure that this remains a best place. Apne acharan se, by your conduct, we have to ensure that it remains the best place. There is no way anybody can point a finger and say that no, something like this, it can't be called a best place. So, again, what is the objective? Many, you know, I say, and I read this this board outside, and I have always thought that this is the most significant pronouncement, what should be there, that you should be a winner. This institution should make you able to be to win. There's a lot of difference between a winner and a loser. And I say that to be a winner, you have to have a game plan. To be a loser, you have excuses. Now, how do you maintain that? You think three steps ahead, two steps before. And always put yourself in the shoe of the enemy or shoe of the other person who is facing you, or the shoe of the customer. If you are manufacturing something or giving a service, then the customer is the king, and the customer, you have to put yourself in the shoes. Once you know, you get into the shoes, meaning you get into the persona of that person and start behaving that what would a customer want from your service, and how would you continue to give this service so that the customer has all praise and satisfaction. In other words, you have to get into his skin, wear his shoes, and understand that. Now, one of the most eloquent way of saying who's a leader is such a person who commands respect. He doesn't demand respect. He commands respect, and he leads by his actions. There's a lot of difference. And why I think that the Indian Armed Forces are such organization which produces leaders and which encourages its leaders, whether it's a lieutenant or a lieutenant general, whether he is a Nayak or a Subedar Major, whether he is a Subedar or a General, everybody leads by his own conduct. And Alfred Lord Tennyson wrote in his famous poem something about leadership. It says, cannons to right of them, cannons to left of them, volleyed and thundered into the heart of all, rode the 600. And ahead of the 600 horse person was the leader, who didn't have a sword in his hand. He had a flag. And he rode through the Crimean defenses and reached the objective. Now, why I'm saying all this is that whether you are in the army or you are in a civil organization, you are being prepared to be a leader. And the leader must understand all the rigmarole, everything, all the mechanics of the organization. A leader has to be a good student. He has to be a good learner. If you stop being a learner, then you are dead. Only a dead article ceases to have the opportunity of learning. You cannot be a living person without learning. And every day you come to situations which are new for you or situations which are complicated. Do I start getting goose pimples or do I start getting bloated or swelling in my hands or legs? Because I don't know what to do. In Sanskrit, it is called King Kartavya Vimuda. Mujhe kya karna hai, mujhe pata nahi. A good leader has communication, talks with his people. He can find out all through experience who is the right counsel. The right counsel may or may not be his second in command. Maybe a very knowledgeable person sitting at an outpost. But the good leader should be able to find out. Even if you are marketing something and your task is that what you are marketing is not giving you good results. Why is it happening? I mean, this product is giving me good result here, but why can't it sell it in this place? What should I do in order to make this product sell? Because your task as a managing director or a general manager is to ensure that your company or organization becomes better, more financially capable, more sustainable. So you counsel with each other or the right persons, and you come to the right solution. Communication is a very important tool which God has given to us. Communication could be verbal. Communication also could be from the internet. But whatever be it, it is important to be able to reach out and not be hidden somewhere under, you know, pillars or posts and not be at the right time, at the right place to provide the crucial guidance to the organization. There are hundreds of thousands of people who have led situations and who have brought in greater good to larger numbers of people. And that is the purpose of us being in a part of a society, the human society. You know, start with mohalla, then your district, then your state and the country. Or you can repeat it in the organization, or it can be repeated in any forces. It has to be, how do you influence the mind of the others and how do we determine their action should be such that it helps the organization? Again, how do you ensure that 1 plus 1 is 11? Now, I would also suggest that there is no challenge, free world. Challenges are there, and challenges shall be there. We cannot expect that there won't be challenges. So how do you foresee the challenge? For that, you know, some time ago I had said, you think of two steps or three steps ahead. If I do this, what would be the repercussion? If I do this, how will it affect there, there, or there? Three different situations. How would it affect this kind of a group of people or objects, and what should I do? So if we do that, that is called game plan. Because you have to ensure that you have a game plan of doing something by which you don't come across to these kind of foreseeable or unforeseeable challenge. And if you play it well, then you can ensure that your organization would be continuously well led. Also, you can have, and today's management precepts teach that kind of a thing. If you have a problem or if you don't have a problem, all right, you say that I'm going to do this. This is my decision. I'll sell milk in, I'll challenge Gujarat and sell milk there. Why? Because Gujarat was sending milk to Bombay. So entire Amul and Mamul and all that direction was Bombay. So there in Ahmedabad. So how do you do that? How many wagons of milk have to be sent so that it becomes economically possible to beat the price of Gujarat in Gujarat itself? And we did it in, I was helped by my officers doing a role play that you become Amul or you become the Gujarati sort of population, and what would they want? And this is how we'll do it. So where from we can do it? Indore, Ujjain, what should be the, should it be road link or should it be rail? And if it goes by rail, where does the milk go and gets it bottled again? This role play is absolutely important in any situation. Likewise, if you want to take a campaign of anything, then you plan it. So what I'm saying is, there is no shortcut for winning. And there's always many, many excuses for losing. And why I consider winning is important is that all, whether your shareholders or your colleagues in the organization or the objective of your organization will be that every day your organization should be able to meet the challenge and come one better. And that is what an organization or institutions like this teaches you. If you are able to write the question itself, how to test the knowledge, that's a far more important accomplishment than to write the answer. Because answer anybody can write. But to frame a question which makes any person to understand the concept is far more important. Therefore, most of us, when a software industry works, they are meeting the requirement of somebody in Germany or USA or Japan who's written the question, and our chaps are writing the answers. A good forward-looking organization should be able to write the question, and those answers would be used for the next, say, 10 years. And then you move into the next lot. And this is called innovation. Because you have written the question that what will I do if such and such thing or these things are creating a bottleneck? I'll find an innovative method, whether it's an object or it's a procedure. So when in 1991, two major things happened in 1991. One of the most important thing which happened was the Iron Curtain came down, literally. Germany, East Germany joined Germany. Soviet Union stopped being called Soviet Union because Russian Federation was born, and a number of other countries were brought out of the Soviet Union. So at that time, a person called Dr. Norman Augustine came to us, and he was the chairman of a company called Martin Marietta. It's an aviation company, thinking company. It doesn't produce anything. It makes the black boxes, which directs the avionics. So Dr. Norman Augustine came, and India's power center is in two buildings called South Block, where the Prime Minister's office, the Foreign Ministry, External Affairs Ministry, and the Defense Ministry. These three organizations sit in South Block. And the other power center is North Block, where the Finance Ministry and the Home Ministry is located. So everybody who were in charge of these two ministries, starting with Cabinet Secretary and others, everybody came to hear Dr. Norman Augustine. And what did he say? He said that the Iron Curtain is even before the Iron Curtain, he knew that Iron Curtain is going down, Soviet Union is collapsed. But what do we do in the United States, the companies? He says that we decided that we will have to stay ahead in innovation. And innovation would keep us always ahead. So how do we do that? He says, prepare new products which will be far reaching, which will be more effective. And even if there is no market, you will mothball it and keep it with you, so that when the competition comes to that level, this mothballed product would be given to the market. And the remaining time, you keep on developing the next lot. So every time a innovation comes into the market, your work is to start with another innovation. So this was 1991. Lockheed Martin was created, and Martin Marietta's chairman, Dr. Norman Augustine, became the first CEO of Lockheed Martin. That's the strength of innovation. And that is what we we require to do. An innovative environment keeps the organization in front, always. So, 94, I had gone to Japan to find out about very low light cameras and many other things. And the Japanese companies, you know, Sony, NEC, Hitachi, they showed me at that point of time three different things: LED TVs, LCD TVs, and 3D TVs, three-dimensional. 1994, three-dimensional TV is still not come into the, but the Japanese have already, in 1994, they have developed the technique, and you can watch the television with, if you wear some glasses, and it looks as if that it's a three-dimensional effect. So, which means that they have developed, they have taken this idea and mothballed it. So even tomorrow or day after, if there is a competition, the Japanese will be the first one to bring a new object, new product into the market. So that is what makes a country or an organization something which is unique. And these kind of challenges is what every person who comes into a temple of learning must be prepared to do. If you prepare for the difficult situations, then simple situations become much more easier to handle. And this is a sadhana in which you have to have an attitude, and that attitude has to be to win. And I wish you all the very best in ensuring that this sadhana, you always are successful and never get daunted if there is a problem. So with that, I'll end my conversation. And would there be some questions?
Would you please enlighten us, like you fought 1971 war and you served, you got a Sena medal also. So what driving force forced you to be into administrative services?
Oh, that's a very, very interesting thing because, you know, after the war, we also governed the two districts of Pakistan, Thar Parkar and Nagar Parkar. And since I was the person who was to get fire, you know, artillery or air force fire, and I had, it was called forward observation officer. So, therefore, I had to roam around all the territory, and I saw and talked with many of our forces, their own problems. Tell you one incident, a very good Jawan, Havaldar called Pran Singh. He came one day and he says that he must go to his village in Ghazipur in UP. Pran Singh was a very fine chap, about 6.5 feet tall, and he was honored by General Manekshaw more than once. Very good soldier. And he says that we have four brothers. Three of us are in the armed forces. And main sahab, main padha likha nahi hu. I'm not educated. I haven't been able to pass Hindi one, or that is equivalent to matriculation. My younger brothers have become JCOs and then they'll become officers also. They're padhe likhe log. So what has happened? My eldest brother, who looks after all our khet? Because, you know, you cannot have all your income from the land, because the land doesn't get you so much income, but the land is very important. So my eldest brother, he looks after the land. And some opponents who want to grab some portion of the land have killed him one day, because when he was coming back, they cornered him and his body was found without his head. So, sir, I want to go and I know kinhone kiya hai. So I must have them apprehended or take action. So anyway, I gave him chutti. He didn't come back on the appointed day. And in Fauj, if you are late, then you are liable to be taken some action against. So I said, Pran Singh is not that bad person, let us wait. And he came back after a few days. And he says, maine solve kar liya, kya kiya? Ke jinhone mere bade bhai ko mara, unko maine pita. And I hurt them very badly. To police ka case tha, to police ko case mein I proved ki maine self defense mein kiya hai. To ye karke main aa gaya. Now mind you, he's not out of the this thing. On top of it, he can be punished because of he's beaten those people. But this is what happens. A jawan comes and serves, and in his absence, his property can be looted by the other chaps. So I wrote a letter. As a captain, I wrote a letter to four persons. The President of India, the Chief Minister of UP, the District Magistrate, and the Superintendent Police. These are the four authorities. And you know, Governor. So Governor of UP and then District Magistrate. So five authorities I wrote. You see, in the army, for your subordinates, you can take up their cause to the highest level. And nobody would say that, how did a captain write to the President of India? It is your duty. So I wrote, and I got some answers, especially from the governor, but some people did not answer it also. Nothing. So after some time, Havaldar Pran Singh comes, ki saab ek baar aur chutti jana hai. He said, kya karoge? He said, I'll kill them. And uske baad mein main mar gaya, tab to theek hai. Aur nahi mara, to jail jayenge, lekin maar denge. Now, this is the story of Indian rural situation. You have to have ability to, you know, to understand this. And you can't if you don't have a dialogue. And so I wrote again to the IG, whose son was my classmate long ago. And I wrote, and then they caught the man, and he was, those days IG were the highest policeman could go, because DG police came much later. So he caught him and they booked a case and many other things happened. What I'm saying is that who are you responsible to? Country, then your men, and then yourself. Anybody who's heard of the oath of the Indian officer, the country always comes foremost, first and always. And then your men under you, is your second responsibility. Third is yourself and your friends and things like that. So then my superiors in that place, the army commander, General Babur, the infantry division commander, Major General Anand, RDR Anand, and then the person with whom I roamed around all these places after the war, Colonel Bhavani Singh, who was also Maharaja of Jaipur. All three told me that you have got the age, you can write the examination, because you have seen everything. war is the most important and the most, you can say, interesting experience. And you've seen it. Now you've got nothing to see. So if you write and if you study, you get in, we'll be all happy. And Colonel Bhavani Singh said, I am also chucking the army now. So anyway, that's how I came in. But I can tell you one thing, that in this civil service, the life of a collector, every day is a war, every day. And you got to really go grapple into this thing. So in my district, I was for 4 years, unchanged district magistrate. 3 different governments came and went, and I was still there.
Good evening, sir. Sir, evening. As you are the advisor of GTU Council, so I also belongs to GTU only. I am now, results are late of 8th semester. So, sir, there are many vacant seats now in engineering also. And many of colleges also have shut down there. In around 4 to 5 colleges in GTU are now shut down. So, what's the reason behind this? Engineers are not, of GTU especially, not getting anywhere job.
No, I fully agree. You see, what is India's population? 1.25 billion or 1.3 billion? What is the structure of Indian economy? Around 60%, 55, 56% of the economy is towards services sector. Then 15 or 16% is from agriculture. And 15 or 16% from manufacturing. Now, that is why what's happening? We are buying Chinese goods in such big numbers that we don't have any manufacturing requirement. So I tell people that, all right, what you should do is, take Pune and see how much of the goods which is, or engineering products which is being made in Pune and sold in Pune. So suppose 100 products, out of which you will find maybe 2 or 3 made in Pune and remaining outside. Now then you say, you do this study, how much of it is made in Maharashtra and sold in Pune? Then you will find that maybe it's 12% or 14%, something like that. Then maybe you could do another study and see how much of what is sold in Pune is made in India. You again would find something as low as 40%. Okay, why? Because at the end of the day, we are buying more goods from which are made in China. Now, if goods are made in China, you don't require engineers to make those goods here. So the only answer is that we must increase our manufacturing, and we must do it at a competitive rate. We must be able to sell it if this thing. If we don't, then I can tell you, we will be only buying goods which are made outside. We have to get all these things in a way that we make in India. And that's one of the most important things. If we have make in India, we will have employment for engineers.
Respected dignitaries, Bala sir, chief guest, and aspiring student managers, I, Prachi Verma, feel very privileged to be the part of Sri Balaji Society. I'm glad to propose a vote of thanks. A wise man once said, "You never stop learning, no matter what age is." Well, what a beautiful start to a new session. A heartfelt thanks to Mr. Shekhar Dutt, sir, for sparing his valuable time with us. Sir, your insights were thoughtful and really inspiring. I thank you on behalf of SBS for making this evening phenomenal as well as knowledgeable. Thank you for enlightening our path, not just with knowledge, but with courage to live. I also extend my sincere thanks to Mrs. Shekhar Dutt, ma'am, and Major Arun Patak, sir, for their gracious presence. Lastly, I also extend my sincere thanks to Colonel Dr. A. Balasubramaniam, sir, for organizing such great interaction with stalwarts. Thank you.